Good morning. It's time for Daily Chapel at the LCMS International Center in St. Louis. The text is Joel chapter 2, verses 12 through 19. The Reverend John Denzer is preaching. The broadcast of Chapel is underwritten by LCMS International Mission and Ministry to the Armed Forces.
Dear brothers and sisters of our Lord Jesus Christ, on this day the Church begins a holy season of prayerful and penitential reflection. Our attention is especially directed to the holy sufferings and death of our Lord Jesus Christ. From ancient times, the season of Lent has been kept as a time of special devotion, self-denial, and humble repentance, born of a faithful heart that dwells confidently on His Word and draws from it life and hope. Let us pray that our dear Father in heaven, for the sake of His beloved Son and in the power of His Holy Spirit, might richly bless this Lenten tide for us, so that we may come to Easter with glad hearts and keep the feast in sincerity and truth. A reading from Joel, the second chapter. Yet even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping, and with mourning, and rend your hearts and not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for He is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and He relents over disaster. Who knows whether He will not turn and relent and leave a blessing behind Him, a grain offering and a drink offering for the Lord your God. Blow the trumpet in Zion, consecrate a fast, call a solemn assembly, gather the people, consecrate the congregation, assemble the elders, gather the children, even nursing infants. Let the bridegroom leave his room and the bride her chamber. Between the vestibule and the altar, let the priests, the ministers of the Lord, weep and say, spare your people, O Lord, and make not your heritage a reproach, a byword among the nations. Why should they say among the peoples, where is their God? Then the Lord became jealous for His land and had pity on His people. The Lord answered and said to His people, behold, I am sending to you grain, wine, and oil, and you will be satisfied, and I will no more make you a reproach among the nations. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Dear friends, now let us also have a revival. Let those who are dead come to new life. Let those who are complacent be stirred to action. Let those who think that they stand take heed lest they fall. Let those who are downcast obtain fresh joy from the Lord. And let the humble hear and be glad. The revivals of the Bible do not begin with our testimonies, but with God's testimony. Peter stood up and addresses the men of Israel in Acts. Josiah brings out the dusty tome. Ezra stands up before the water gate. And Moses is always and again bringing his radiant face down from the mountain as a mediator of the Lord's words, not his own. How then will revival come to our church? But will come as it came to Adam in the first place, from the breath of the Spirit of God, the Lord and giver of life, who blows neither silently nor secretly, but clearly understood, sanctifying in truth. God's word is truth. This breath of God inspired the Holy Scriptures. And it breathes on His apostles with forgiveness of sins that comes from the vivifying power of Christ, who Himself lives. The revivals of the Bible don't consist in our ecstatic joy, but they always pass through repentance. Moses teaches a song to Israel of recollection. The crowds at Pentecost are cut to the heart. Josiah tears his garments. The Word of God corrects us. It calls out to people who are busily going about, struggling to stay alive, or afraid that there's nothing worth living for anymore, and it says, no, no, already you are not living. You do not even know what true life is. You must be enlivened, revived. Will you protest and flail about a little bit to show just how alive you are? Or will you admit that if revival is needed, if the Lord calls for it truly, then I must be dead, as good as dead? The revivals of the Bible are also deliberate. Now, I haven't followed that story in Kentucky very much. I did see, though, there was some debate about how spontaneous that revival really was. It may have apparently been planned or prompted by something beforehand. But that's not a problem. What is spontaneous, what immediately bursts forth from the heart of man, is not more likely to be righteous, spiritual, beautiful, or true. Lord knows what lies in the heart of man. But thus Joel also, long ago, called for a revival beforehand. Trumpets announce a solemn assembly and consecrate a fast. Of all people, the Bible's prophets can't be accused of engaging in mere formalism, that is, going through the motions of some tradition without believing what it means. No, listen to Joel himself. Rend your hearts, not so much your garments. And this is, of course, at the same time, uttered alongside all of the forms of repentance that he enumerates, which impinge very much on everyday life, with fasting, with mourning, with no more weddings allowed, with solemnities sometimes austere, sometimes dramatic, but certainly, and at the heart of it, with more frequent assemblies. Dear friends, the 40 days ahead of us, Lent with all of its traditions, this is not commanded in the Bible in any of its particulars. Lent is not a sacrament, but it is a revival, and it's a thoroughly biblical one. This kind of regular planned repentance, with fasting, with assembly, even with the ashes of mourning, this sort of revival is called for among us. It befits a people. It befits a church picked apart by locusts, fretting over grain and oil, reproached among the nations, and yet all the while still prone in ourselves to arrogance. And if you're a bit skeptical of mass public revivals, as I definitely am, well then, why don't you take this call of repentance to heart, to your heart? Because it is not the sins of some others out there that we need to dig up or amplify or even clarify. It is my sin. Let me put my mouth in the dust and learn humility. I am the dead one. Spare me, O Lord, for your mercy's sake. Revive me. By your baptism, fasting and temptation, by your agony and bloody sweat, by your cross and passion, by your precious death and burial, by your glorious resurrection and ascension, of course, by the coming of the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, revive us, Lord. Turn us again, O Lord, and we will be turned. And here, dear friends, here is the only testimony that can do that. I am the Lord, gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. So our revival will last for 40 days, in addition to our usual day of revival, of course. The Holy Spirit will assemble us around His inspired word. We will learn about the real enemies that assault us and see that truly we are as good as dead in our trespasses and sins. But do not fear, because after 2 days, He will revive us. On the third day, He will raise us up again to live with Him. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you for joining us for Chapel. The broadcast of Chapel is underwritten by LCMS International Mission and Ministry to the Armed Forces. To learn more about LCMS International Mission and Ministry to the Armed Forces, visit kfuo.org/chapel.